to tell you about my nephew. When he was 3 years old, he was sick and dehydrated, and he was admitted to the hospital with diagnosis stomach flu, which is a common ailment for toddlers. And yet, he did not get better. After 9 days, my nephew had an MRI scan. His parents, my brother and my sister-in-law, were waiting outside, and all of a sudden they saw a medical specialist approaching. They were running and entering the door of the room where my nephew was in it, lying in the MRI scan. My brother vividly remembers the way the white coats were flapping after them as they entered the door. My nephew had a brain abscess, and the size of his brain abscess was 5 centimeters. This painful family history raised my interest in cognitive error in medicine, because all of a sudden I realized that physicians, that they make decisions all the time, that you could say that making decisions is about the core of being a physician. And yet I can tell from my own experience that we are barely educated in decision making or in recognizing cognitive error. I myself am now in a position to develop a bachelor education for medical students. And I try to pay attention to cognitive error and decision making in my teaching. I've once taught with a professor in surgery, which I thought was really cool. And together we discussed with the students, well, how lifestyle factors or occupational factors can make you more prone to making cognitive errors. Factors such as stress or lack of sleep or time pressure or peer pressure. And I think it's rather impactful when a professor in surgery says, well, you know, it's not cool to sleep only 3 or 4 hours a day. You should have 7 at least. I think we as public and occupational health professionals can play a major role here in identifying these factors and in changing the system in order to make medicine safer and better. But I chose not to focus on that task here. It would be a bit too easy, I thought, and it might make us prone to, well, collectively become victim of the blind spot bias, the cognitive error which, well, says that people are always more sensitive to other people's errors than their own. Instead, I would like to go into the question here. What is it that we as public health professionals can learn from the research on decision making and on cognitive error? First, I will give some background information. This field of research distinguishes two systems of thought, conveniently called System 1 and System 2, and I will tell a bit about those. And, well, this information is very easily found in Daniel Kahneman's book, Thinking Fast and Slow. And then I will apply this knowledge to public health. Now, System 1. System 1 is the oldest system from an evolutionary point of view. We share it with animals. If we see a large spider, we withdraw, and that's System 1. If we see an angry face, we think, ah, better avoid that. Or if we recognize someone in the audience, then we become happy. System 1 helps us through the day, and it guides most of our decisions and responses. It works continuously. It works fast. It works without effort and without conscious control. And there's one more thing that I would like to point out about System 1 here, is that it loves good stories. Good stories about individual cases. Now, System 2. System 2 is the very human system. It's rational, conscious thinking. And it's active when we are doing mathematics or when we are making a difficult maneuver with our cars. It's much younger than System 1 from an evolutionary point of view. And, well, it doesn't work that easily yet. You need to switch it on consciously. It works slowly. It takes a lot of energy to use System 2. And it often feels hard, like, I'm thinking, that feeling. And now on to public health. One way to apply the knowledge on System 1 and System 2 on public health would be, how should we handle ourselves as public health professionals? But first, I will focus on the question, how should we address the general public? Well, when we address the general public as public health professionals, we often provide good information. And then we actually focus on the public system too. We say things like, and I quote from a general website, anything that influences the likelihood of developing diabetes or of worsening the condition also increases the chances of dying from the condition. Well, this is a very System 2 sentence. Can people understand chances and statistics? This has been investigated, and yes, they can. They can understand statistic data. They are able to believe statistic data. They can be so surprised about statistic data that they go out and tell their friends about it. So by then, System 2 is definitely convinced. And yet, if the statistic data do not match beliefs people already had floating about in their System 1, then they will not change those beliefs. And these beliefs are intimate. They are about self, about your life, about the people you love. So nothing will change because System 1 is the system that gets us through the day. Now, how can we reach System 1 as well? It's fairly easy, actually. You can reach it by a surprising and emotional story, experience, or event about one single case. I have two examples. Well, first, my own standing here is due to the surprising and emotional case of my nephew. It changed the way I see my profession, and it got me reading and learning and teaching even. So that's a change, I think. And another example might be that when the US public was asked in research to estimate the frequency of different causes of death, the public thought that death by car accident is 300 times more frequent than death by diabetes. Well, if we imagine the state of the US public, then we know that this can't be true. The problem here is that, well, in the collective mind, people have so many stories stored about, well, single cases of car accidents, stories that are vivid and emotional. And they lack stories, vivid and emotional stories, of death by diabetes. I think that we as public health professionals have to connect death by diabetes, that abstract concept, to individual faces and to individual stories. Not to scare the public, but because people have the right to receive useful information, information that changes beliefs and that promotes action. Well, and that in short would be information about individual cases. Now, on to my next topic. What can we as public health professionals learn for ourselves from research on decision and error? I would like to propose here that we make a conscious effort to employ System 2 while we are doing our job. And I will focus here on the tension between coherence and ambivalence. System 1, with its love for good stories, is very fond of coherence, of stories that match, fluid, easy thinking, just goes on. And it does not like ambivalence. It could be this or it could be that. It doesn't like doubt or uncertainty. We as human beings need System 2 to doubt, and we need System 2 to endure ambivalence. I think that we as public health professionals have to be experts in actively tolerating ambivalence. We often work with people with, as we call it, bad lifestyles. They have bad eating habits, or bad habits in smoking and drinking. And still, we have to be able to look beyond the bad lifestyle. We have to be able to connect with the strength of these people and to activate a sense of human dignity. And this may sound as the normal and obvious thing to do, but unfortunately, in real life, it can be a struggle to keep this ambivalence alive. Bad lifestyle, good people. Especially if a public health professional is already, well, overburdened or exhausted. I've got another example, a very sensitive topic, the detection of child abuse. When I myself worked as a well childcare physician, I noted how difficult this task is. I often liked the people, the parents, that were sitting in front of me, and yet sometimes I really had to suspect them of child abuse. And it was difficult to tolerate this ambivalence. Nice people, bad things. And perhaps it even made me having to tolerate the idea that I myself, while being nice, would also be able to do bad things. Now, if we as public health professionals do suspect a case of child abuse, we never know what the outcome will be. It's terribly uncertain, this situation. And your whole system one is screaming at you, there's ambivalence here, there's danger. We should withdraw and avoid, quick. And yet, we have to persist. We have to do our job. To conclude, I hope to have shown that knowledge on decision-making and cognitive error is useful in prevention and public health. And I proposed here to pay attention to the system one of our clients and to the system two of ourselves. I've pleaded to dive into storytelling and into ambivalence. I started out with the story of my nephew, and I'm very happy to tell you that this story ends well. Despite this orange-sized hole in his brains, he recovered in an amazing manner. He's 6 years old now and goes to a regular school. Our adult brain would not be that flexible. But still, I would like to end here with the idea that we too have to use our brain plasticity. We have to keep on learning. Since this would be my final and more hidden goal of this TED Talk, to demonstrate the value of connecting public health to other fields of research and knowledge. Public health offers such benefits to society, and yet it can also be so difficult to get results. I think that we owe it to society to collectively harvest whatever useful knowledge there is out there from other fields of research. In that way, we can become as effective as possible. And as a useful by effect, we train our system too to the max. Thank you for your attention.